All right. Welcome back. Long time no see. Any questions before we begin? We get group three presenting today. They're gonna give us an awesome presentation. Is that right? But before that, we'll do social psychology, right? So before, previous chapters, we kind of looked at psychology from an individual perspective, right? Thoughts, feelings, behaviors, from an individual, right? Now we're gonna look at the influences of groups. So we're gonna look at sort of two ways of thinking about this. Do attitudes shape behavior, right? Or does behavior shape attitudes? What are some of the forces when we interact with others? Does it change the way we act, change the way we believe? Are we role-playing? Are we being genuine? We'll look at all sorts of things like that. So we're looking at social thinking and social influence, right? How does the brain changes the way it thinks when it interacts with others and the presence of others, and what's the influences on those groups, on us, some antisocial relations and some pro-social relations. Okay. All right, defining social thinking, right? So we're talking about social psychology. Focus on social influences that explain why the same person acts differently in different situations, right? Why do you act differently at home than you do here? Why you act differently when you get with your best friend and when you are around strangers? You act different in church, you go elsewhere, are you wearing a mask, are you being yourself? Are you just role-playing, right? Are you acting throughout life? Are we all just a bunch of actors in the theater of life? This is all a play and we're all playing pretend to be our best selves, right? Think about that. So we'll look at role playing, right? Do you look like students? Do you talk like students? Do you act like students? Do I look like a professor? Do I talk like a professor? Do I act like a professor? Okay. Are we role playing here in life? Okay, attribution theory. Behavior of others explained by crediting either the situation or the person's disposition. Which means that usually we attribute two factors. Like, hey, that person did what they did because that's who they are. Or we say, you know what, maybe that person did what they did because that situation. Is it the situation that made them act the way? Or is it just because of who they are, the disposition, right? Think of crime. Crime in Chicago, carjackings, robberies, right? Held up at gunpoint. Do we just say, no, evil person. Locked him away, never look back again. He did the crime, did the time. Or do we think more about it, like, wonder what made them do that? Wonder if they had different circumstances, which would they have different? You have money, which you try to get other people's money. You have more education, which you make the same decision or choice. You have better opportunities, which you'd be doing something else other than robbing, stealing, and killing people. Right? So two ways. So usually we are dispositional. Men are more dispositional than women. Women usually kind of give credit, I say, to the situation. With men, we kind of have the sense that we should have mastery over ourselves. So we usually say, no, it's your fault. It's absolutely your fault. No excuses, right? You're like, well, you know, but this happened, right? I was late because of this, and I didn't do the work because of that. I didn't do this because of that. And usually, men, we don't give that much leeway. We say, no, it's you. It's just you. Women have a more of a tendency to say, like, well, let me hear the story. Tell me what happened. Hear you out and get some context. So we usually attribute things, either these two things, right? So if someone cuts you off on the way to Dominican University, first thing pops in your mind is you probably curse them out either in real life or in your head, and you probably want to drive up and see what they look like, so you can match a face with whatever you think is stupid or they did, and you don't care what the situation is, right? You don't care, maybe they just got the phone, grandma had a heart attack, she's in the hospital, had to hurry up, right? So we don't even consider that, it's not even a consideration, and the first consideration is like, you're an idiot. Which shows we have cognitive flaws, another cognitive flaw. So fundamental attribution error, tendency for observers when analyzing others' behaviors to underestimate the impact of the situation and overestimate the impact of personal disposition. So usually we overestimate, like, no, it's just your fault, it's who you are, right? You are who you are, and we underestimate, like, what's the story? Give me some context. What's the situation? What's the circumstances? Factors that affect attributions, culture, right? Well, we said we're individualistic culture in the U.S., right? In the West, which means we probably do say it is your fault, right? We don't have that much leeway when it comes to a lot of crime, right? Right. Well, think of a crime of passion. You walk in the house and catch your significant other cheating in the bed or something, and then you murder them. Right, in our, and maybe in our cultures, the social justice system or the criminal justice system, okay, no exceptions. No exceptions. Right, no consideration or nothing else. What if you never had a crime record before? What if you never did anything remotely like that ever before? Right? Was it the circumstance or the situation that made you do it? Or are you just an evil person? In fact, if you never did it before, I don't know what you actually say. Would be kind of flawed or faulty thinking, Your Honor. Right? You say, we don't care. Right? You did. We don't care about the circumstances. Which, again, is maybe flawed to some degree. So, maybe we say we should consider both. Yes, you should suffer and be penalized for it. But maybe we should consider some other stuff. Or maybe we should make it a conversation like, hey, why are people doing this? Right? So maybe we could talk about it to change the environment, the circumstances. In collectivistic cultures, right, mostly in the East, usually they want to hear the story, right? It's not just about, like, you know, you being a evil person or something like that. It's more so like, what made you become whose behavior? So it really depends on who we're talking about, right? So we say we are biased, right? We're biased to a lot of reasons, gender, race, religion, all sorts of things, pick and choose, whatever we're biased by. But usually it will affect how we make those attributes, right? Well, you should say, that's what they expected from those people, right? So we do that type of prejudice sort of behavior towards certain groups. And then there are exceptions to our attributions, right? We say our deliberate, admirable actions are attributed to our own good reasons, not to the situation. With age, younger selves' behaviors are attributed to our traits, and attributions matter. To a person's disposition or situation have real consequences, right? They do have real consequences. So we say, hey, 13-year-old kid, it's carjacking people, right? Another carjacking, 13-year-old, like, what do we do? What's the issue? Do we just say a person's evil or bad? Right, no, they probably cause a great deal of harm, and they should probably be punished or something. But what made the person do it? You know, is there economic circumstances? Are they getting proper education, maybe? Is it the environment that caused them? Family upbringing, nurture, right? So we have to consider these things if we want to, because they have real consequences, right? You send somebody to jail for 20 years and they come back out and do the same stuff. Like, nothing's changed. Why? Because the environment of prison is just as worse as the environment of any crappy neighborhood. It's worse, right? So it really doesn't rehabilitate, so you're not making any changes. All right, now this is an old one. This is from 2015. I'm pretty sure none of you remember this, but 9 African Americans attending a church Bible study in Charleston, South Carolina. So a younger white male went into a church and shot up 9 African American church members with an assault rifle and killed them all. And that's it. You know, should we just say, should we consider his situation or circumstance, or is he just an evil person? What do you think? Let's say school shooter, right? Walks in school, grammar school, young kids. Person has no criminal history whatsoever before they do this horrific act, come in, shoot up the place. What's your thought? What's your position? Natural, innate, evil person, right? It's just them. That's who they are. They're evil. What do you think? There's some other stuff that should be considered. What do you think? School shooters. Yes. So what should we do as a society? Lock them up, throw away the key?
Yeah, you deserve jail time.
Okay, that's a good argument. Anybody else has a counter argument? Who says we need to hopefully figure out what's wrong with them and rehabilitate them and reintroduce them back into society at a later point in time?
After they do the jail time.
After they do the jail time. So you gotta suffer a little bit, but okay. Life in prison or 10 years?
Life in rehab.
Life in rehab?
I feel like you need rehab.
So you would never let them back out into society again?
I feel like if they get to a point where they move themselves, if they ask for, forgiveness from whoever, they accept their actions and what they did, I feel like eventually they could get better.
Anyone else who feel like, hey, we should have some sympathy to figure out what's their background, what made them do this? Like, should we consider what made them do this, or should we not consider what made them do it? Because it doesn't matter if people are dead. Yeah, it's going to go to trial, and we'll have those arguments. We have to come to some sort of conclusion, right? But many people would probably say, depending on what if it's your family member, you don't want to hear about, you don't care about his circumstance or something like that, right? Yeah. Right? So we have to think, it's a little bit of both, right? It gets a little complex. But we should think about it at the least. And then some attitudes and actions. Attitudes affects actions. Attitudes affects actions. If you feel that you are successful, you'll be a success. You'll do the things you actually motivate yourself to be successful. Feel like you're a loser, you take on the role of a loser because you take on the mindset. That's your attitude. So you can actually change yourself internally to become or manifest what it is you actually want to have. And vice versa. Right? Actions affect attitudes, right? So here they're giving the foot in the door phenomenon. Right? Foot in the door is an old sales marketing strategy, which means that I can convince you on one little thing to do one tiny thing for me. I can probably persuade you to do the big thing, which I really want you to do. Right? You think of clickbait, right? You go on YouTube and it's like, little thumbnail and it has like something crazy as the thumbnail and it has a tagline, you're like, oh, okay, this should be interesting. You click on it, it's something completely different. You're like, that's clickbait. There's nothing to do with that, right? So why do they do that? You want the foot in the door phenomenon. Right? If you get your tiny thing to click on it, you might watch 3 minutes of the video, right? It might convince you to watch the whole video all together. If you can sell somebody, if you can get somebody to even listen to, say, your reasoning or an idea for a campaign, donation, charity, something, you can convince them to sign some sort of petition that, you know, could go through legislation or something. But you first need to put a foot in the door. It comes from actually back in the day when they would do door-to-door sales. A lot of housewives would be home and immediately they would just slam the door on somebody knocking and sell them something. So the marketers would just put their foot in the door. They're like, hey, just let me hear, just let me tell you this one small thing, right? Like, hear out my one small thing, we can get you to two other things, right? So actions can affect attitudes as well. So look at peripheral root persuasion and central root persuasion. All right, we'll finish this up right here and then we'll have a little time. All right, attitudes and action, role playing effects and attitudes, right? So we'll look at next class in Bartle's prison study. Very famous, one of the most famous studies in all of psychology. Philip Zimbardo is a professor at Stanford. He did a mock prison at the university, and he recruited, you know, X amount of people to role play as prisoners, X amount of people to role play as guards. And what he found that after a while, like even though it was his students, like the distress and the dynamics of being prisoner or guards. The students start to act like real guards, and they start being very authoritative and took it way too far, right? And then the students who were prisoners were highly distressed, and they came together as groups to be like, we gotta mess them up. Like, next time they come, we're grouping together, we're taking them down. It became real, like actually start to believe in it, and they had to shut down the study because, you know, highly unethical, like, you know, fighting each other and stuff like that. Which goes to show you, we role play. You do look like students. And if somebody were to walk in here every day with a three-piece suit each class, you would look at them weird. You'd be like, they don't look like they belong here. But to them, they say, well, why are you doing it? Well, I'm manifesting something other than just being a student. Like, it sounds weird, right? Yeah, it's all weird. Cops look like cops. Cops act like cops. Police, right? You're a drug dealer, never spot a detective, right? Or, you know, you could spot somebody undercover, right? Can't fake acting like a cop. Why? You took on that role. And that role requires you to act, right? This is a role too, Professor Ross, right? I look like a professor, dress like one, talk like one. So do the other professors, right? Oh yeah, professors kind of look and dress, right? We become that. We literally become that. So whatever it is you want to become, you can manifest it if your attitude starts to follow the road that you're trying to play. All right, let's stop here for lecture, and group three is gonna come up and give their wonderful presentation.
Yeah,
it'll still pop up.
I think there was something.
Can you press top one? Can you press
the
go back to the
actual project?
Hold on.
Do you have it like in just an attachment?
Yeah.
If not, I think I got a Google Slides. All right, and so I'm thinking next Monday we take off. How do you feel about that?
Take off?
Yeah, cancel class for Monday. What do you think?
Oh, cool.
Right, that way everybody can maybe enjoy a full week for Thanksgiving, I was thinking, right? Since we don't have any presentations or anything. Anybody disagree? You disagree? You want to stay in class or anything? What about back there? What do you think? Cancel class? Or? I don't know. I'm not sure.
Not the COUS.
try to just do it one on one.
No, because I have to come to this for my seminar and my chem class.
All right, we got Charlize, Jess, Fiona, Jill coming up.
Excuse me.
And here's the clicker. Just click that button to go in there. So look at the hot one. All right, whenever you are ready, take it away.
Psychological insights into social dynamics of high school. Okay, so the first one is social hierarchy. So this one talks about how students in high school feel like they need to meet their parents' expectations. And there's a lot of roles. So for example, like popular kids, the fine arts, the, you know, the anime people, the druggies, the stoners, the brains, you know, there's a lot of categories in high school. And everyone like competes with each other.
Why it matters. So belonging and like social needs is one of Maslow's like part of the hierarchy of needs. And through like social dynamics, students are able to find where they belong and is essentially a way for them to fit in your school. This like social dynamics gives students understanding of how they'll be perceived later in life. And then it also emphasizes high expectations, peer acceptance, and it separates individuals' differences into like different groups. And it also brings people's sense of belonging. And it can influence one's success. What impacts the student's social status? A lot of it is based off of locus of control. So basically, low levels of social connectedness relates to students to think they have really no control in what group they're put in and how people perceive them as. So these are the people who are actively trying to fit in. And they're really dependent on how others perceive them and what their judgment is of them. They, instead of focusing on themselves, they tend to focus on what other people want, so they're trying to give them that. And then it basically just dismisses one's self-concept and the perception of others. And most of these people have an external locus of control, and it can lead to academic failure. So people with an internal locus of control feel that they are able to really have like a say in where they are and in what groups they belong in. A lot of these people are very well-grounded and they have the ability to work with others who are not like similar in the same groups as them. You're able to understand differences, have no effect on your sense of belonging, and that it also influences their sense to cope with one's ability to fit in. And it really brings engagement with peers in school activities.
Some long-term effects that could happen in one's social life. Mental health. Depending on like if a person's like antisocial or has any other like things that are stopping them from being able to be social, that's a long-term thing too. And it also could come from how you build relationships with others and your experiences with other people. It can also affect the way you think about relationships long term. Personal development when it comes to long term. Obviously, we all grow up and we outgrow people. So sometimes a person's values aren't the same as the other, so you gotta let them go. It's just you personally, how you feel about the people you are around. Social media, the internet is everywhere, you can't escape it. So that also affects the way people interact and the influences it has on you. It can also be long-term. Some negative side effects of the social dynamics would be peer pressuring, whether it comes to students just trying to meet the expectations of their groups or like their school environment or anything like that. Relationships in high school, those are also like a lot of peer pressuring when it comes to like sexual activities or like anything that you might not want to do with your partner. Bullying, unfortunately there is bullying in these social dynamics in high school and just can also be a long-term effect.
Social dynamics affect on students' education. Effects on students, helping students become more confident and comfortable about learning. You also get like the social environment with people and learning how to communicate and talk and just kind of like overall having those norms with you. It prepares you for the future on how the real world might be with people, different types of people, different personalities. More students get engaged and interested while learning with other people, making learning fun, social skills, building group mentalities, promoting self-assigned roles, so knowing your role in like a project and knowing your role like within the school, and you're like hall monitor, you do this, or you're a sport, you're an athlete. So yeah, that's just the effects it has on the education. Many challenges on students' education with social pressures. Many students have withdrawals of interest in education due to unstable household environment. I believe like if you don't, if you're not like comfortable, if you don't have like a stable home back home, like it's hard to come to school and kind of fake it out, you know, fake it till you make it. So I feel like those kind of collide together and make it look really strong. You're stable at home, you're stable at school, you're good. Having a supportive environment for students is very important. So some like pressures you might have, like being judged by others, you know, like the fear of being judged, or like having no interaction with peers, like just kind of being antisocial, like to yourself. It kind of leads to like depression, anxiety, make you like feel depressed at school. You know, there's like a lot of pressures like when you're in high school, like think about like, oh, what do they think? You know, what if I mess up?
And lastly, for social dynamics on drugs in high school. So high school, you can tell there is a lot of kids that use alcohol, marijuana abuse. Studies show that there's multiple social systems over a long period of time. So 60% of high schools use alcohol and marijuana. And also like even 30% of middle schools too as well. So within that 30% of middle schools, once they go into high school, the percentage goes up as well. And also here's also a percentage of age groups over all the years of drug and marijuana abuse. And
all right, excellent. Let's give a round of applause. Any questions for group three about high school? Come on. You guys just left high school. I know there are going to be some questions. All right, tell me about everyone's transition socially from coming from high school to Dominican or coming to college for the first time. Like, what has changed? Has the type of people you hung out with now versus high school, has that changed at all? You change with things you actually do? Your behavior has changed? Did you stop doing stuff now that you were doing previously in high school? Are you doing new stuff that you didn't do in high school? Who could attest to the changes? How have you adapted? Who can tell me their experience?
I would say I've become more myself. Like, I feel like in high school, you're really scared of, like, what other people think and stuff. But honestly, like, just jamming into college, I think, like, none of it really matters. Like, it's just really, it's not as important to think what others think.
Why do you think, like, in high school, that's so, important? Like, And why is it so important for us to care what everybody else thinks? As opposed to like when you get to college now, like who cares? Like what do you think really is the big difference?
I don't know, I feel like it's really just based off of really, like, in middle school, you kind of see, like, those different groups, but in high school, that's when I feel like you really start to see it, and you see, like, the different groups, and who like these people, and who doesn't like these people, so I feel like they're always trying to do the best of it.
Yeah. I think probably, like, you being legal to do certain things you couldn't in high school might be the biggest factor, right? Because now you can get an apartment, right? Probably got a car, you can go do things that you couldn't do in high school. So high school almost is still almost like a prison. Right? You're kind of like forced. You're still forced to do stuff. Here, college, you don't show up, whatever, you don't have to show up, right? No one's going to call you or email you. It's up to you, right? It's kind of left all up to you. High school, you're still social services and truancy. Anyone else? Anyone else got some unique adaptation experiences? How have you changed? Or do you feel like you haven't changed? Anyone feel like there's still this kind of the same thing? It's just overblown high school or something like that. What do you think? How do you feel about college? Yeah.
I think sleep. Well, I have a little bit more sleep.
More sleep.
High school, yeah. High school is like really
everything. Okay. Yeah, and you can make your schedule, right?
Exactly.
So you got a little bit more flexibility with college. Great, that changes. What about drug use? You find that's not a thing here, right? Because probably like in high school, there's so many close-knit groups. Like everybody kind of knows where to get stuff or do stuff or who's doing what. Here, nobody has those type of groups, right? You don't really know each other like that. Even in this class, you don't really know each other like that, right? But in high school, it's different because we've seen each other for 4 years and the same thing. You kind of figure everybody out. For me, high school, a lot different. Right? I mean, in high school, I went to Lane Tech or graduated from Lane Tech High School. Well, I probably hung out with drug dealers and gangbangers. I was hanging out with the Latin Kings, the Cheaties, the DDs, the Stones, all of them. And they also drugs, and everybody was doing a bunch of legal stuff. I never really did the stuff. Like, I hang out with people and do, you know, but I wouldn't contribute to, like, stuff that would give me in big trouble. Which means I was always in my own mind, right? You couldn't really force me to do anything, but I was still capable, right? So, yeah. Unfortunately, a lot of those guys are in jail, locked up, or dead, right? So it's not good to follow people. And we'll look at that, it's important that you did this, like, right now. We'll look at social forces, how we could all become Nazis. So we all can become prejudiced and racist, a-holes, right? Depending on the social forces out there to try to influence us, to force us to believe in certain ways. How it all happens. All right, excellent presentation. I will see you all Friday. And then Monday we're going to have off. Let's show up Friday. We're going to end off on a good one. All right, everyone, enjoy the rest of your day.